Warning, this podcast contains violence, sexuality, gore, and other horrible and disturbing things. Listener discretion is advised. Also, the hosts of this venture are ignorant dipshits, so please do not take anything they say as fact, and enjoy the show.
Now, are you sitting comfortably? Good, then we'll begin.
Today we had 15 homicides and 63 violent crimes, as if that's the way it's supposed to be.
It is our basic human right to be fuckered.
A second plane now has crashed into the other tower of the World Trade Center.
Put chemicals in the water that turned the friggin' frogs gay.
The defendant shall be incarcerated for the rest of her natural life with no possibility of parole.
You are not machines. You are not cattle. You are men.
We were somewhere around Barstow, on the edge of the desert, when the drugs began to take hold.
Oh, call the very Veritatis.
Hello and welcome to Occulte Veritatis podcast. My name is Sage Murray, and joining me today I have
Richard Bigley,
Leon Filger,
Ood Gallifrey,
the soundboard demon,
Don Kessler,
Dory. So when I first started researching this episode, it was supposed to be on the troubled teen industry. However, it is not on that. We are going to be investigating the dark, dark world of Synanon, which is connected to the troubled teen industry, which I promise you an episode on.
I love Cinnabon.
Oh, Cinnabon.
I miss airports now.
A unique combination made from the world's best cinnamon. The finest, freshest ingredients baked fresh before your eyes.
I guess we're going to need some poison because we're talking about a cult.
So, what's your poison?
Alrighty. So
someone poisoned me.
Once again, this comes from the weed we grew in the house. In a PAX vaporizer. So I'll just turn this on to pass it around.
Is that vaping dry flower?
Yes, it's vaping flower.
So it's vaping flower, but I need one of y'all to just hold it until it vibrates, and then you can sip it like tea.
It hasn't vibrated yet.
It'll do it.
Oh, it vibrated. Okay, so I just like...
Yep. Yeah, I think the PAX uses like hot air like to basically boil the THC out.
Yeah.
I liked smoking it like that.
Yeah.
It's smooth and popcorn-y.
Yeah, that was good.
I always love when the weed tastes like popcorn out of a vaporizer. Makes me feel comforted. And then I'm usually getting high shortly after, so yeah. It's good. It's like watching a movie at a movie theater, except on my couch.
Yeah, I don't nearly die as often, or like as much when I'm sucking on a vape.
I liked that a lot more than regular smoking it.
Anybody want another hit?
No, thank you.
The PAX 3 is a handheld vaporizer that offers a convenient and tech-savvy way to consume cannabis flower and concentrate.
Are they sponsoring this?
They are not. I wish, because those things are really expensive.
I have a Da Vinci.
Ooh.
I like my Da Vinci. It was good.
Yeah.
It wasn't harsh. Wasn't nothing. It was good.
It was like being on the Titanic but finding room in a lifeboat.
Oh, I like that. Yeah.
That's nice.
It was like being on the Titanic and not hitting a fucking iceberg.
Sure, your friends and your butler are dead, but at least you're there. You're in the boat. And the rescue boats are coming, maybe. It's fine. You know.
Have you seen that Rick and Morty episode when the fake Titanic doesn't hit the fake iceberg and everyone's really mad?
Sir, there's not a problem.
What do you mean, there's not a problem?
The guidance system isn't putting us on a direct collision course. This ship is about to completely miss the giant iceberg.
Well, do something. Steer into it.
I'm trying.
It's too late. Ladies and gentlemen, don't brace yourselves.
I forgot how much I like vapes. I didn't cough, so I would say 10 out of 10.
Yeah.
And another thing about vapes is you can use the duff inside to make some edibles or something. So makes your weed go double, which is lovely.
Unless you do what I do and don't measure your weed and just like say, too much.
Yeah.
Oops.
Too much is always better than not enough.
That's right. Yes. Yeah.
That is the exact opposite of harm reduction. Start slow and go slow. As opposed to too much is better than not enough.
Are we good?
Yeah, we're good. I'm ready.
You ready? All right.
It's just a fire. Warning, we have to take more
different from most prisons on the surface, gray and forbidding, but in a special sense, unique. For here, prison authorities have allowed inside the walls members of Synanon, an organization of former narcotic addicts who believe they can help criminals as they have helped themselves, help them with an unusual type of therapy.
It's wrong? What's wrong about it? What do you mean you? What about you is wrong about it? You're happy?
We're trying, nobody's happy or laughing at you, man. We're trying to get you to come up with some kind of feeling.
I don't know how!
You're doing it now. Why stop, man?
The first time Candy Latson saw the inside of a jail, he was 19 years old and hopelessly addicted to narcotics. Looking back, he describes himself then as a small-time criminal and a big-time dope fiend. Now 29, Latson hasn't taken so much as aspirin since joining Synanon 6 years ago. He is now a regular and welcome visitor at Nevada State Prison. He carries with him into these cell blocks an idea that crime, like dope, is an addiction, and that both are an addiction to stupidity. Synanon attacks stupidity with truth, truth spoken by men who know what it is to murder yourself with drugs and crime. When Latson first visited here in 1962, he found suspicion and distrust. Candy Latson.
We had heard that some of the guys had threatened to riot and send word through the grapevine to me, you know, what they thought of me, and, you know, why don't I go to Birmingham and, you know, help, you know, the sit-inners or the stand-inners and, you know, things like this. And, you know, but it's kind of like their problem. I had a job to do, so I went in to do my job.
When Dederich founded Synanon in the late 1950s, the organization was hailed as a constructive, self-help, drug and alcohol rehabilitation center. Group dynamics, discipline, and the force of Dederich's personality brought sobriety and successful withdrawal from heroin and other drugs to hundreds of followers. Synanon grew, eventually becoming a $20 million business, supported through its own profit-making farms and small industries, and by generous contributions. With success came others, middle-class people, professionals, non-alcoholics, non-addicts, who simply sought a different way of life. They found it in Synanon. Dederich, many former members now say, changed too, becoming more authoritarian. He ordered that all male members undergo vasectomies, that women and men shave their heads, that members change partners, swap them for new mates. Last winter, Dederich claimed an unflattering article in Time magazine had provoked threats on his own life.
We never start anything. We never do and never had. But nobody is going to mess with us. Nobody.
So because it's a Sage episode, we're going to talk about a cult that basically spawned all of the modern tough love teen programs that are around today. Way back in 1913, a guy named Charles Chuck Dederich was born. Throughout his life, some bad shit happened. He kind of had like a tough upbringing, and he ended up struggling with alcoholism. He was described as being super charismatic and well-spoken, often speaking uninterrupted for hours during the Alcoholics Anonymous meetings that he attended to help with his alcohol use. And this was around 1957. So we jumped forward in time a whole shitload.
Oh, yeah. He was busy. And, like, I guess a lot of people had it hard back then, eh?
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a lot of unchecked trauma in those ages.
Mm-hmm. Well, and at that time, people who struggled with illegal drugs were often not welcome in AA because it was seen that their addiction issues were like super duper different from people who struggled with alcohol. So after dropping some LSD and some LSD trials, Chuck decided that he wanted to start his own program to help those people. Fun fact, it was rumored that Dederich actually coined the phrase, "Today is the first day of the rest of your life." So good for him.
Oh, I guess that's still used some places.
Chuck started a small group called Tender Loving Care that quickly gained a large following. Now that he had a big group, he decided he needed a cooler name. So he went with the Synanon Foundation in 1958. Synanon was a made-up word combining togetherness, sin, with the unknown, anon. It started out as a two-year residential program, but eventually our buddy Chuck decided that its members could never graduate because full recovery is never possible. More on that later.
Oh, so once you enter, you can't get out?
Yeah, after about 10 years of that.
Jesus.
In addition to this addictions recovery thing, the Synanon organization also developed a business that sold promotional items, which was super successful and for a while made around $10 million a year. The addictions group started out in a small storefront, but moved to like a super cool abandoned armory on Santa Monica Beach. Charles had contacts in the media and in Hollywood and was able to really push and promote Synanon. In 1965, like before all like the weird communal living stuff happened, in 1965, there was a Columbia Pictures movie called Synanon, which was set at and filmed in Synanon. And there are some fun clips from that of people yelling at other people.
Oh, goody.
Which is pretty cool.
Synanon is a real corporation. Its business is junkies. Chuck Dederich is the ex-drunk who dreamed it up and fights to keep it from becoming a nightmare.
Get out of that car and shut up. Stand over there. Put your hands against the wall. Get in that cell and stay there.
But nobody tells me what to do.
Ben, the ex-con with the killer's fist tensed so tight for a fix they bleed.
Look, Betty, I don't make scenes with chicks because I've got other things on my mind.
Joni. Dollface with a deadly, expensive appetite.
What are you, my nurse?
No, just another dope fiend.
Zanky. A hip-hop head, up from the gutter to grab anything he could get.
All throughout the years, they were able to buy more and more properties, including like huge beachside hotels for the program. Now, what you really want to know, what were the practices of Synanon? To join, you had to be very fucking committed. So first, you had to go through a really intense interview with the leadership to even be considered for the program. Once you got in, you were forced to quit all drugs, totally cold turkey, enduring withdrawal for the first few days in the program. And keep in mind, these were not doctors, these were not nurses, these were not medical professionals. These were just people.
Yeah, and just to make it clear, withdrawal is often deadly. The words chemical dependence are not a misnomer. Withdrawal from several substances that people can become addicted to, if quit cold turkey, can kill, can permanently damage or traumatize, or cause further harm if the withdrawal isn't taken correctly. That's why people who are going through alcohol withdrawal are given small portions of alcohol to stave off the worst of withdrawals. That's why people that have a substance use disorder with opioids are given methadone and other things like that to stave off the worst effects of withdrawal. And going through withdrawal properly should be done under the supervision of medical professionals, not some dudes who decided to start a self-help program and do the cold turkey method. The cold turkey thing is one of those things that sounds good. The gut logic is there. You're like, oh yeah, if you want to quit something, you just quit, right? But it's not that simple. Things are rarely that simple. There are complications involved, and these people in Synanon probably put a lot of people at risk telling people to quit cold turkey.
There's not really a whole lot of regulation or oversight on some of these things, is there?
No, especially not in 58.
They just let anybody create a recovery center, and there's no rhyme or reason or anything to it.
Mm-hmm.
And the shock of withdrawal, especially with people who have pre-existing complications, like, can kill people.
Exactly.
Oh, yeah, having recently gone through a few days of withdrawal, it's fucking horrible.
Yeah.
Right? I bet. And also, for the first 90 days in this program, you were not allowed to be in contact with any friends or family. And eventually, that 90 days stretched into the entire time that you're living there. So for the first 10 years the program operated, Synanon members entered into a 1 to 2 year commitment that broke down the program into 3 stages that aimed at preparing participants to rejoin society. During the first stage, members did like community and housekeeping labor. Next, they worked outside the community but still lived in the community. And finally, they were allowed to leave but still had to come back all the time for meetings.
After they were probably already good and brainwashed, right?
Yeah. But it's kind of the shit really happens after 1968. So after 1968, Chuck transitioned Synanon into an alternative society and changed the program into a lifetime rehabilitation program with the assumption that the participants would never truly be well enough to return to society and to their previous lives. So you're so fucking broken. If you come here, like, this is your life now. And fuck you if you want to leave. So what's so bad about Synanon? Helping drug-addicted people sounds pretty sweet. I wrote, well, hold on to your butts, because shit's about to get fucked. The biggest therapeutic practice that Synanon used was called the game, which you have all now lost. Sorry about it.
Ah, shit.
It's been 6,000 years since I lost the game.
I'm sorry. Sorry, not sorry. So it was basically like a big, like, group therapy session. One member would talk about themselves, and all the other people would basically hurl terrible insults at them. They were told to be intensely critical of everything, swearing, and just basically being super intense dicks.
Jesus, that's similar to what Ted Kaczynski went through at his college.
Mm-hmm.
Had all his history and beliefs just torn apart by people.
Yeah, well, like, that's basically, like, they'd have someone stand in the middle, and they would be like, you're a fucking crack whore, bitch, fuck you.
Jesus.
Like, and just everyone in the room just all hurling these, like, insults. They're like, you're fat, you can't stand up, blah, blah, like, you're stupid. You know, like, it was really, really intense.
And if I understand, these are the same people who've been already isolated, right?
Right.
So these are the only people in their lives doing this to them.
Exactly.
They, like, sort of cycled in and out, didn't they? Like,
yeah.
You know, you would eventually get your turn to shit on the other people in the circle is basically how that worked. Like, it was this, like, I don't know. I think, like, psychologically speaking, it's kind of like, I mean, now don't take anything I say with any seriousness, because I'm certainly not a professional at all. But, like, to me, it's like the shared trauma thing where it's traumatic to you. Mm-hmm. But, like, everyone else around you is going through it or will go through it or has gone through it.
Yeah.
You know, so it's like, oh, yeah, I was really shitty in the circle today. And then you're like, yeah, I know. Mine was kind of rough, too. You know, and you can kind of bond.
Yeah, you're very much, like, trauma bonded. And then after the game was done, you weren't allowed to do that. You went back to, like, being, like, friends and family, basically. Yeah.
Man, people really had to go out of their way to get the Xbox Live experience in the days before the internet.
Right?
It's like a bunch of 12-year-olds in the Call of Duty lobby.
Yes, here is a complete accounting of who has fucked my mother, my father, and 600 strangers on Xbox Live.
Yeah. Oh.
I would just like to point out that a few minutes ago when I called Sage Mary a slut, it's not because I'm slut-shaming. You slut as hard as you want.
I know.
Okay. I have these worries that the listeners are going to be upset that a small demon from hell called you a slut, and we're all sluts.
It's all good. Yes.
You can leave your friends behind.
Because if friends don't slut, and if you don't slut, then you're no friends of mine.
Unless they're perfectly okay with not being sluts.
Yes, guess then that's also cool.
Yeah,
that's cool
also too, actually. It's okay if you really want it, but slut it up too.
You do, yeah.
Be as slutty as you want or as you don't want, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Off you go. So obviously this was like a break them down to build them up kind of tactic.
What is about to take place is what Synanon describes as a gut-level discussion. What Synanon calls, looking at it the way it is.
If you got such a tough left hook, how come you got to use a pistol pistol with people out in the street?
Because it's more convenient.
It's more convenient. You know what, man? If when you're left hand, you rub the first right in the head, you got knocked out with one punch.
You know, does that answer your question?
Not hardly. Hey, if I didn't know you, I would say that you were the next thing to Sonny Liston. You know, the way you talk and carry on, you know.
But look at
that. How many fights do you have?
Sonny Liston.
Anywhere.
I've had quite a few.
You had none. You've had none.
You've had two fights
here in this joint.
And they're phony.
Yeah, in the ring.
And you got knocked out.
You know nothing about no physical fitness. You got some little punk up there. You're just grabbing onto what he says.
You said that the things that you do kind of point out to you that you're a psychopath.
I've been under the influence of alcohol or narcotics, you know.
But wait a minute.
Put me in predicaments where I come to jail.
You weren't under the influence when you belted whatchamacallit up on a tear.
Well, you know, that was a different thing.
Why was it?
Hey, look here. Since you're aware that you
had... I stopped. You know, if I hadn't been under the influence, if I had been under the influence, I wouldn't have, you know.
Hey, look at this.
So what?
Look at this.
Well, why?
Well, you know, I haven't found out why yet. You know, except he pushed my butt.
No, that ain't the reason.
Why don't you look at it the way it is? You had a setup. That's the way. That's why you hooked him. You had a setup. You had a pushover.
Look at this, Don.
You knew you could take him. You hit a sissy. That's all you hit.
Sissy run his mouth, too, you know. I'm not particularly.
Everybody else in there was running their mouth. Why didn't you have one of those other guys?
You know, they dumb.
Yeah, they dumb.
Who else was in that cell? Who else was in that cell? Hit in the head.
The Synanon session has been called an emotional battlefield. What these men are attacking is destructive behavior and self-delusion. But what you are hearing is not aimless anger or senseless hostility. One premise of Synanon is that you attack what a man is doing, not what he is. What prevails in the end is reason.
Okay, let's forget about that.
This is how that happened. This is how that came down.
Right, I agree with you. Let's forget about that. Let me say this. Now, I've been knowing you for over a year. I have never, since I've known you, known you to be what you say you were, a psychopath. I've never known.
Well, this is what has been told me.
Yeah, but you're repeating it. I can only believe what you tell me because you have no reason to lie. So I can't believe what you say. You know more about you than I do.
I'm qualified to say this. You know, I'm not qualified, but I'm going by hearsay.
But you said, okay. So somebody said you're a psychopath, so you like to go around calling yourself a psychopath. So I guess whatever a psychopath is, you act like a psychopath long enough, you become a psychopath, right?
Yeah, that's possible.
Okay, crazy. Now, Porter just told you something about this illusion that you're under of being, you know, the heavyweight champion of the whatever it is.
No, I'm not under an illusion.
Wait a minute.
I know
what you are. But you are. Now, you really know nothing about fighting. You haven't really had that many fights. You've had a couple of fights in a ring with a couple of kids that you sent up to the gym and they couldn't go over three rounds. Neither could you. You know, you probably won two fights out of at most. You know, but some kind of way you walk around with this image. With your chest back and, you know, swag shoulders and, you know, I'll hook him like this, I'll hook him like that. And, you know, for what? I'm thinking, hey, you know what? After about 7 months in Synanon, you relaxed for about 2 months. And you was the most pleasant guy that was around here. Everybody would go into you. You did a complete flip. And everything, you had something to talk about that was valid. People were, even the guys in the Synanon, you were moving. You was in this direction. You was moving out and up. You know what I mean? You was going up in status, right? You come all the way from the bottom. You start moving up, right? Am I lying? So far. This true?
Oh, you're right.
You was going up. And you was going out. Now, for some kind of way, you didn't reach a standstill, and you're going back.
The participants endured harsh humiliation, sleep deprivation, isolation, and hard labor. This was attack therapy and textbook brainwashing. This verbal and psychological abuse was referred to as haircutting. So again, more on that later. Haircutting. Dederich said that freedom to think to a dope addict was like giving a gun to a baby. So don't think. Dederich preached act as if, which meant to not question or think about anything that Synanon did because thinking is what got them addicted in the first place. Just trust that what they were told and act as if it was right.
It's very telling how, like, textbook this is. A lot of these patterns were repeated again and again in future cults, and it's almost like this is, like, the carbon copy, the original, you know? But I know there's older ones, but it's so textbook. Like, sleep deprivation, malnutrition, don't think, just do. While already preying on a vulnerable population, so there's power dynamics at play. It's surprising that this was allowed to stand and, like, own buildings and operate in fairly, like, positive public view for a while. They had a Hollywood movie that played to their favor, you know? Oh, wasn't that nice?
Which is pretty fucked up, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. So people not involved in Synanon, like people who weren't struggling with addiction problems, were allowed to come and partake in the game, because what's better for recovery than random people shaming you for literally whatever preconceived notions they may have about you? So they basically get someone who, like, say, someone who is involved in sex work and who is addicted, and then they'd get all these, like, random people just hurling terrible, disgusting insults at them. And, you know.
Jesus.
Like, how traumatizing would that be? I can't even imagine.
And there are recordings of these things happening. I played one earlier, but we have to remember that these are videos of Synanon on their best behavior. Testimony from members of these game sessions, these attack therapy sessions, their testimonies paint that the attacks got much more personal and much more aggressive and ramped up in brutality, the verbal attacks and the harassment in these sessions behind closed doors when recordings weren't happening. They were very well behaved on camera, and even the stuff you capture on camera would be hard to sit through.
Well, not to mention, like, that sort of trauma, wouldn't that send people back to their vice more often than not?
You'd think, but they weren't allowed to leave. They had made the commitment, right? So the group lived communally. Babies were taken away from their parents and raised in what was called the hatchery.
Gross.
Mothers who wanted to see their children were referred to as head suckers, which is gross.
That's like a derogatory term. Like, oh, you want to see your kid. That's bad.
Yeah. Like, it was seen as like a weakness and like a what the fuck do you care about your kid for? They're being raised in the hatchery.
I'd like to think that those kids were properly nurtured in the hatchery, but I don't know.
They were not. Yeah. They were also brought up in this Synanon school. So the group also received kids who were considered to be like juvenile delinquents or who were having problems with addictions on their own. And they were court ordered by the state of California to attend Synanon. California and a bunch of celebrities were like totally in love with Chuck Dederich and Synanon.
I mean, I'd like to see the insanity of it, but like, there are politicians today that are like advocating for like conversion therapy and sick, like Rick Santorum. That, like, I think he recently advocated that it should become a regular thing.
Yeah, like all this like fucking like backwards ass thinking, and they were all like enamored with this Synanon break them down to build them up kind of mentality. Synanon attracted all sorts of non-addicted people as long as they transferred all of their funds to the group. So you were allowed to go as long as you could pay.
So it's kind of like a Patreon in a way.
Yeah, kind of like our Patreon.
Like our Patreon. You want to join the Occulte Veritatis cult?
Mm-hmm.
For as little as a dollar a month, you can join it.
Yeah.
If you want to go give $6.66 a month, you can join Team Richard.
Or you could join Team Sage.
Team Richard's way better.
No, I don't know. I make paper or origami frogs.
Team Leon sends you condoms.
I forget what I saw, what I sent last time, and I'm probably going to send something different this next time. Maybe a little bauble or a little poem I'll write or a small picture that I'll sketch. We'll see.
Would it be illegal to send weed? Could we send them weed?
I think that's illegal.
I mean, sometimes...
I mean, it's a gift of weed, though.
You know, sometimes I'm rolling joints when I'm, like, writing letters. What if, like, a few little, like... I don't know if it fell in, you know?
And you can totally mail weed. Like there's lots of mail order weed, yeah.
But, like, to the States, could you do that?
But if you're Canadian, it's legal.
If you're Canadian, I think it would be okay.
Probably wouldn't send weed to someone in the States. That sounds like asking for trouble. But you could totally send weed from Canadian to Canadian over the mail.
I'll soak the letters in turpentine to throw off the dogs. It'll be fine.
Can you mail weed legally, Canada? Canadians can send cannabis to other adults of legal age.
There you go.
That's from Canada Post.
Not illegal, and I had my very own custom strain called Bigley Kush. And I don't know, knocked Oud on his ass. It was great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good.
And I'm a pretty prolific smoker, and it knocked me down pretty good.
You are. Yeah.
So if you sign up, you may or may not get weed, depending who you are and if you're Canadian.
Well, yeah. Fuck, I don't have anything like that to offer.
You know, if I messily roll some joints, you know, maybe some will fall in.
Falls in, whatever. Yeah. So,
who's to know?
Patreon roulette. Maybe you get some accidental weed. Maybe
accidental weed.
I don't know.
Either way, you get a fistful of Cheerios. You know,
and a card or something.
Yeah.
A heartfelt thank you from all of us.
We love you.
And it's something you keep on your bedside and smell when you're lonely.
Join the Patreon.
I'm a Patreon team. I'll send you like the leftover parts from Ood's PC, like a couple of screws here and there, maybe a hard drive tray, whatever.
Were you the one that made our fancy-ass computer?
Yes, I am.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's my pleasure. It was fun to build.
Awesome. So, Eartha Kitt, Leonard Nimoy, Jane Fonda, and Natalie Wood. Throwback!
Oh, yeah.
To my Natalie Wood episode.
Yeah.
Were just a few of such celebrities who stopped by to visit. They may not have been super involved, but they were tangentially involved. I know that Leonard Nimoy donated a lot of money to them.
Man, fuck, the 60s were weird.
They were so fucking weird.
And even if they didn't donate, like, just through their influence, like, they and even if they didn't outright say it, they, like, their celebrity condoned it. Like, it increased that place's reputation. Mm-hmm. And, like,
fuck.
Yeah, like, it was pretty sketchy.
Yeah.
So, back to the kids. In the Synanon school, the children were taught about the upcoming Holy War and to basically praise Charles Dederich as a god.
He's a very sheep.
Dederich was an AA fanatic who then volunteered for an LSD trip, which made him think that he saw insights into mankind, and he began to read at the library Eastern philosophies and various books. And the AA speeches, which had religious overtones, Dederich was now being philosophical and psychological, and developed his own following, who would come to his apartment. And they developed what would be later called the game, where they would sit in a circle and attack each other's behavior, supposedly with the rude truth, but truth wasn't required. You could say anything to cause an effect. And Synanon got discovered by Life magazine, which did a 14-page spread. Santa Monica arrested him for operating without a license and without his own, and he went to jail for 60 days, which made him a martyr, and more money now began to pour in. And the fact is, he wouldn't keep statistics. And what he really had was, is he had a lot of old-timer addicts who had had enough. And if they could get themselves into a home and fed with fellows like themselves and bond as a group, they were capable of staying away from drugs. The fact is that the ultimate statistics done by 64 showed that Synanon had no greater success than Kensington Hospital. And Dederich, by 66, realized that most of the people who left Synanon went back to drugs. So in 67, he decided that the only cure was that no one ever leaves. He also had ambitions of building cities and changing the world. And so in 67, he ended the idea that anyone would ever leave. And he also instituted a concept called containment, which is we don't go off the property. We don't associate with other people. And he began to build cities in Marin County, later in Visalia, later in Lake Havasu. And that they would be complete cities with their own movie theaters, swimming pools, riding stables, motorcycles. And so it was a cradle-to-grave society. Now, when you do that, it cut off for Dederich any opportunity for him to ever come across anybody who would say no to him. In other words, he's being followed by people saying, yes, Mr. Dederich, yes, Mr. Dederich, no matter how crazy.
So he acquired absolute power over these people.
Which corrupts
absolutely. And that power corrupted him.
Yes.
Oh, Synanon also became a church after they got called on not paying taxes.
What the fuck?
What else are you going to do when you don't pay your taxes?
I mean, that's the same thing I did when I got caught by the CRA, so.
I'm a church!
Yeah.
Church of Richard Bigley.
Fun fact, Leonard Nimoy once sang a song called Bilbo Baggins.
Oh, that song's fucking, it's such a fucking bop. Play it now.
It is deeply terrible.
No, it's not deeply terrible. It's amazing.
Cast it
It's the
now.
Best. Cast it now. This can be a part of the episode.
In the middle of the earth, in the land of Shire, lives a brave little hobbit whom we all
Fuck
admire.
His hair is shiny.
Long wooden pipe, fuzzy woolly toes. He lives in a hobbit hole and everybody knows him. Bilbo
Baggins, the brave little 3 feet tall.
Fuck, the 60s are weird.
It's little hobbit of them all.
I think those are supposed to be hobbits.
Oh. The import fee was incredible.
Maybe Bray can mail us some hobbits.
Oh, yeah, that'd be good.
Yeah.
I mean, they are short. They might fit in a letter.
they might.
Send them by letter mail. Yeah.
So there was very much like an us versus them mentality from the outset of the group. A cult of personality surrounding Chuck Dederich really developed. The group was living in fear of the outside world because they were told that the mainstream was trying to fuck with their recovery. That the only safe place for them was within the bounds of Synanon. So, you know, like making sure that everyone was kind of bound into this group and this group mentality.
Christ.
Dederich used other disgusting control techniques, such as forcing the women to shave their heads. Remember hair cutting?
Yeah.
All the women, they all had shaved heads, and it was just for the cult stuff, like not because, you know, it looks badass.
Yeah, and again, this is more classic cult shit, like... People express their individuality through how they wear their hair. Even if they wear it bald, that's a choice. But making everyone bald in a group, that reduces the amount of individuality in that group by force. So it's just more classic cult shit. Take away their individuality so they don't think for themselves and they just go with group leadership. They feel more like a follower, a drone, instead of somebody who can make their own decisions. By taking away just bits of their individuality, little bits at a time.
They had assigned marriages. At one point, they decided that basically fuck kids. So they had forced abortions and forced vasectomies. So, I mean, like, keep it at equal.
Yeah.
What better way to ensure your cult lives on for another generation than to prohibit procreation?
Well, not saying he was smart. He was very much like a hard ass. So, obviously, legal problems arose. Remember the juvenile delinquent kids who were forced by the California legal system to go live at Synanon? Well, a whole shitload of them were abused and smuggled out in, like, an underground railroad.
Oh.
Basically, on one of their, like, sites, the neighboring rancher would help smuggle the kids out of this cult.
Jesus. So there had to be some kind of air about that this place, like, wasn't treating these kids well.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you got a cult living next door to you, I can imagine, you know, you get kind of annoyed with some of the shit you see. And
right.
Like,
yeah, and a whole shitload of them, like, were abused and smuggled out, and they talked about what went on. And like I said, the reason to all of a sudden become a church? Tax evasion. People who tried to leave the group, well, they were called splitties and often had the shit beat out of them by the current members. Dederich would also often assign young troubled women to sponsors who were middle-aged men who would exploit these young peoples for sex, jeez, which was also called 13th stepping.
Oh, so it wasn't even like a look down upon thing. It was like a accepted part of the group?
Yeah. Jesus. So they would be just like, here, have this 16-year-old, 45-year-old man named Glenn.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it was really fucked up. An example of violence against people who left the group. So on September 21st, 2008, so this is recent, people from Synanon tried to murder a former member named Phil Ritter. He had been trying to get his child out of the cult and had gone to the authorities, like, complaining about the forced vasectomies and situation that they were living in. Synanon retaliated by clubbing him over the head, almost killing him. He ended up being in a coma and getting an almost fatal case of meningitis.
Meningitis is an inflammation of the lining of the brain. It can come through bacterial or viruses, but it can also be caused by trauma. So this is very much a trauma-caused inflammation that can kill people very easily.
So Paul Morantz, he was an American attorney and investigative journalist, and he wrote like a ton about the cult, and it also almost cost him his life. He had his first case regarding Synanon in June of 1977. He said, by July and August, I realized what I stepped in, but it was too late to get out of it. While he was in a rush one day, he arrived home and put all of his, like, Synanon evidence papers and books and stuff on the kitchen counter. And then he noticed something dark and elongated through the grill of his mail chute. He wasn't wearing glasses, so it was kind of fuzzy, and he just assumed it was a scarf. It was not. He was bit by a fucking rattlesnake that Synanon members put in his mailbox.
That's fucking hardcore.
I know. They removed, like, the rattle, so it wouldn't be like...
They removed the rattle?
They removed the rattle and stuck this rattlesnake in this, like...
Snake lawyer assassinations.
Yeah, snake lawyer assassinations.
They're like Inspector Gadget villains.
I know.
Well, of course they peeled the rattle off this rattlesnake. They've been sniffing dicks this whole time.
Like. Yeah, right?
So let me take you back to that October day in 1978 when you stuck your hand in that mailbox and felt these fangs digging into your hand. How vividly do you remember that day?
I remember it vividly, moment by moment.
Yeah.
The only thing I can say to you is that the human mind is not a computer. It doesn't register every fact and compute, and no voice went off saying, danger, Will Rogers, danger, Will Rogers. I had come from a meeting with the AG's office asking for protection in my life. I was very tired. The Dodgers and the Yankees' first game of the World Series was starting on TV. I wanted to forget Synanon for one moment and watch it. And I saw out of the corner of my eye as I entered my house that something oblong was in my mailbox. I wasn't wearing glasses because I didn't own any because I was too vain. And I often didn't put in my heart contacts because they were too painful. And I sort of knew the name of the streets between my home and my office. I thought maybe it was an oblong package or a scarf that some kid found and stuffed in my mailbox. Now this was a time in which before I start my car, I would search underneath it. I would look both ways, crossing the streets. I wouldn't enter my house if my dogs weren't barking. And yet with all these precautions, I just didn't think. I just nonchalantly turned open and stuck my hand in, and when the head came out and bit my hand, I remember thinking, no, this one was too stupid. They can't have pulled this off. Mm. You know, and like gin rummy, it was like when you make a discard and you think, oh, wait a second, I want to pull that card back and discard another. I was like, I wanted to reel it back and smartly look inside before I opened it, but it was too late.
So after the snake bit you, what happened next?
I tried to remain calm. I knew that firemen would have to come, and I had to secure the house so no kids came in the house. My dogs was my pattern at the time. Tommy and Devin, when I came home, they greeted me and then ran out and played in the front yard. When I screamed, they were now heading full charge back to the house, and I had to lean over the snake and shut the front door on my dogs. And
who found you? So
well, I went to the back of the house and kicked out a wood block that held the sliding glass door shut, and then I went out the side door of my house and locked it. I locked the front door, and I started screaming to my neighbor Edie Dittmars, Edie, I've been bitten by a rattlesnake. It was Synanon. Call for an ambulance and get me ice. And I was on the street. Apparently, I was told that I went over to Edie's front door demanding ice, and that I actually unhinged her door, pushing so hard against it. And then all the neighbors came out and pulled me on the ground, and everyone came over with buckets of ice. And as luck would have it, there was a professor, Irv Markowitz, who was home early to go for a religious holiday, and he had just finished a course on what to do with rattlesnake bites. And so he tore off his shirt, tied a tourniquet around my arm and tried to cut and suck out the blood.
Yeah, I've never been bitten by a rattlesnake, so on a 1 to 10 scale, how painful is it?
It's extremely painful. It's not like the movies where John Wayne goes, spits and jumps back on the horse and goes after the bad guys. It's like having your hand in a vise. See, part of the poison kills, but another point destroys tissue and softens it so that it can swallow the animal. And that is very painful because it's destroying the tissue inside your hand. I once made it comparable to having your hand in a vise and someone's cranking it up. And then there's a pause, and then they start re-cranking again. Later years, there's a story about someone who got bit on the hand by a rattlesnake, and he used the same analogy.
Hmm. Hmm. Did you come close to dying, Paul?
Well, that's what the doctors told the media, and that's what I was seeing on TV. But they would tell me inside, you're doing better than that. Don't pay any attention to what we say on TV.
So you never heard a rattle, did you?
No. Later in the hospital, and they said to me, are you sure it was a rattlesnake? And I thought of the V-shaped head, and I said, yes. And then I said, but you know, I didn't hear rattles. And of course, later I found out that they had cut the rattles off the snake.
So this assassination was discussed with the leader of the militant wing of Synanon, which were called the Marines, and Chuck Dederich himself.
And the militant wing?
Yeah, they had like...
A military?
Yeah, they had like kind of like a militant wing of it, where it was like their own little like mini militia.
Yeah, and I just quick Googled it now, but just to give you an example, one of their purchases, this is just one of their purchases, there could be more purchases, was $200,000 worth of guns from a single gun store, which is $1.3 million today worth of guns. That's a lot of guns.
Yeah, every organization needs a paramilitary wing, you know?
Reminds me of Scientology and their squirrel busters.
Yeah. Yeah, there's lots of like very hardcore similarities between Scientology and Synanon. Like there's a video, if you look up Synanon the game, is a video where it like compares how what they did in Scientology. I forget what it's called. It's some like stupid like bleep bloop 877 name, like a sci-fi name.
Found it. TRO, Bull Baited, and the Game.
TR0, Bull Baited.
On TR0, Bull Bait, the coach attempts to distract the student or break concentration in any way. And if he does that, then the student is given a flunk and the drill is started again until the person can sit there having fingers pointed very close to his eye, being yelled at, screamed at, jokes, whatever, until he can just sit there and not react to it.
Now in this drill, Jesse's going to be the coach and I'll be the student. So Jesse's going to bull bait me until I can sit here comfortably no matter what he does.
Ready?
Yeah.
Start. You have an eye tick. Flunk, you flinched. Start. You have an eye tick. Oh, you really think you're smart now, huh? You really think you have it together, huh? Why are your eye jumping around like that, huh? Oh, Lord, my head is hurting so bad. Ah! Pay attention when I'm speaking. Look at you. Looking like some bedpan in a mental institution.
Yeah, and the aggression and the search for the non-reaction when, I guess, having insults and criticism thrown your way has a lot of similarity to the bull baiting that takes place in Scientology, where they will, as shown in the video, they will, with quick movements and aggression, they will try and bait people into flinching or reacting. You can see how the two have the similar type of trauma bonding style of quote-unquote therapy that are done by these cults.
So after the whole like rattlesnake incident, a woman named Mary Robson, who was wife of one of like the like high up Marine leaders, whose name was Douglas Robson, went to a neighbor of Paul Morantz's mother and left her card so that Morantz would know Synanon knew where his mother was. So they're also trying this like, I know where your family is, I'll fuck up your family.
Yeah, yeah, like taking pictures of like you eating with your family on a Polaroid and putting it in the mailbox, like that cloak and dagger mafia bullshit.
Right.
Yeah, this is classic gang shit. Like,
yeah, it's really fucked up. So like 6 weeks later, after the whole like rattlesnake thing, the LA Police Department did like a big search of the ranch that turned up a recorded speech by Dederich in which he said, in quotes, "We're not going to mess with the old time, turn the other cheek religious postures. Our religious posture is don't mess with us. You can get killed dead, literally dead. These are real threats. They are draining life's blood from us and expecting us to play by their silly rules. We will make the rules. I see nothing frightening about it. I am quite willing to break some lawyer's legs and next break his wife's legs and threaten to cut their kid's arm off. That is the end of that lawyer. That is very satisfactory, humane way of transmitting information. I really do want an ear in a glass of alcohol on my desk."
Okay, so just to, that was Dederich, right?
Yeah.
Who, everything just kind of started when he went to AA, though. So, like, AA set forth the events that have led to this.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. I just, like, you know that meme where they got, like, the little dominoes and they got them stacked up and they have, like, one event?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's that one.
Yeah.
And yeah, first tiny domino, Dederich goes to AA. 10 dominoes later, he's expressing a desire to have lawyers' ears on his desk and alcohol. Things escalated. And quickly.
AA is, like, kind of cult-like.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, aren't they, like, as an organization, generally, like, just decentralized themselves?
They are completely decentralized, which, but, like, the way they collect dues at every meeting, the way that they explain addiction as being a character flaw that you have to beg gods for intervention to cure.
Like, you can't do it on your own. You're powerless against, yeah. It is very cult-like, so those...
And going through, like, the 12 steps, it gets you deeper and deeper down the rabbit hole of AA.
I see.
Yes, and then, like, once you're in, it's hard to get out because you become someone's sponsor, and then you're still involved. Like, it kind of keeps you in there.
You get your sponsor, and then your sponsor checks up on you when you don't go to meetings, and it's, they keep you in there.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it can be court-ordered and all kinds of shit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So later, a super drunk Chuck Dederich was arrested, and two other, like, Synanon Marines, one of whom was Lance Kenton, son of musician Stan Kenton. Who's Stan Kenton? He pleaded no contest to charges of assault and conspiracy to commit murder. While his associates went to jail, Dederich avoided imprisonment by pleading no contest to conspiracy to commit murder, agreeing as part of probation to formally step down as the chairman of Synanon and agreed to have nothing to do with running Synanon. Most of his remaining time, he was segregated in Synanon as the foundation tried to revert back to early images and goals.
What is a cult without its thought leader, though? Like, what
he was still there. He just wasn't running it.
Okay, this is the whole, like, this is like when YouTubers have their account banned and then they get a new account, and under YouTube's terms of service, you can't have another account.
Yeah.
Once you've been banned, they're just like, no, this is my grandma's account. She just lets me upload on it and
Dan Kenton.
Yeah, who's Dan Kenton?
A popular music and jazz artist, pianist, composer, arranger, and band leader.
Stan Kenton's artistry and rhythm.
So there were more criminal activities that were alleged against Synanon. They were alleged to have been involved in the disappearance of a woman named Rosalina Cole, which occurred in late 1972 or early 1973. So Cole had received a court order to enroll in Synanon before she disappeared, and she has not been heard or seen from since.
Oh boy, she's probably in a hole somewhere. I mean, I'd like to hope for the best, but that's how these things usually turn out.
Right?
Same with, is it David Miscavige's wife?
Yeah. Where is she?
Yeah, hasn't been seen in years.
Yep.
Yeah, just for context, I haven't looked this up directly, so wait for our Scientology episode to actually see if I know what I'm talking about. But from what I remember, David Miscavige's wife hasn't been seen in a long time, and Apparently, a wellness check was done on her by a police officer, but that police officer may also have been Scientology adjacent, so he may be a biased observer doing that wellness check, so I don't have much confidence that she's okay. Maybe she is, I hope she is, but yeah, as far as I know, last time I heard, she hadn't been seen in years, besides that one, in my opinion, tainted wellness check. Scientology. We're going to cover it. We're going to cover it eventually.
In like mid-1978, NBC Nightly News produced a segment on the controversies surrounding Synanon. And then after the broadcast, a few of the executives of the NBC network and its corporate chairman allegedly received hundreds of threats from Synanon and its members. They continued on with the reports and they covered Synanon and they received more and more threats. So like, despite some of its controversies, I can't even say it right. Controversies. And like its inevitable downfall, they were bankrupted in 1991, but they still had those people that still were like, don't talk bad about Synanon back in 2008. So I'm assuming that they probably still have adherence to this day, but they were like officially bankrupt and dissolved in 1991. Mm-hmm. So like despite all of that, they were credited with curing some people of their addictions. They were credited with curing temporarily some jazz musicians, and they were praised by motivational speakers, like a woman named Flory Fisher, where she credited Synanon in curing her of her heroin addiction. Like, I mean, they were shit, but maybe they helped a few people.
You can really tell by the language they use how much they misunderstand about substance use and substance addiction. Like, using language like cure, like addiction doesn't work like that.
There's a branch of Synanon that was founded in Germany in 1971 and is still in operation. So that one's still going. So they still do have, like, adherence around. And that's it. The end.
Yeah, like, I'm not surprised that like, a cult would draw upon a vulnerable community like that. Like even,
easy marks.
Yeah. Scientology, like, as much as I dislike it, they tend to target more people that are well off, people with money, people that can fund them. But this seems more like they're targeting a very vulnerable community. And even if they only have a little bit, they'll gladly take what they have and take the person as well.
Yeah, they want that clout.
And to be like, even court ordered to have to attend that, you know?
Yeah. Like I said, like the California government was like in love with Synanon.
Government funding, government sanctioning, I guess.
Yeah. And then they like helped him out with like the tax evasion stuff. Mm-hmm. And we're like, yeah, you're a church. Sweet. Imagine, no problem.
Imagine being court ordered to pay $1,000 to a cult and then end up having Leonard Nimoy scream in your face for 20 minutes.
Right? Jesus.
I think I'd pay $1,000 to have
Lemon Nimoy
come and scream in my face for some minutes.
Okay, but let's like cut out the cult elements of that one. Well,
that's a sexual thing.
It's really just a fetish, you know.
Right.
Yeah. It won't cure me of any of my substance issues, but and like, sure, like they make claims that like they help people, some people like get over their addictions and all that, but like, you know, if you have a thorn in your toe, I can cure that by cutting off your foot.
Right.
Like, is the extra harm and the extra trauma caused by, like, getting to that goal worth it? Like, it just seems like there's more kind and equitable ways to do those things.
Oh, for sure. 100%. Yeah. And then keep in mind these tactics for my next episode, which will be actually the troubled teen industry, which gleaned much of its inspiration from these break them down to build them up tactics used by Synanon.
Do I get to shit talk Dr. Phil?
Oh, yeah, that was literally in my notes. Okay.
Fuck Dr. Phil.
My original intro to this episode before I changed my tactics was, today we're going to be delving into the dark and problematic world of the troubled teen industry, and we'll therefore be talking a lot about Dr. Phil, so we had better get into some poison.
Fuck yeah.
Spoiler alert, we did not talk about Dr. Phil, but we will be talking a lot about Dr. Phil.
If I'm able later. To obtain a Dr. Phil bald cap, will you wear that while presenting?
Yes, 100% I will.
Excellent. Okay, good
I would like nothing more. I will like find a fake mustache. And I'll start talking like this.
Is Dr. Phil just white Steve Harvey?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, good. Just wanted to make sure.
You've got to acknowledge the problems in your life.
Yeah. This is a changing day for you. Anyway, for Occulte Veritatis podcast, I have been Sage Murray, along with...
You've just lost the game, Richard Bigley.
Leon Filger.
Ood Gallifrey.
The soundboard demon.
I just lost the game, I'm Don Kessler.
And I'm Tori.
Yeah. Fuck you, losing the game.
Everybody lost the game.
God damn it, Sage.
You're all fucked now.
Love you, bye.
Bye. Well, you were in for a treat just because of how Sage's research fell out. The next episode coming up is going to be the troubled teen industry, so we laid down a good foundation of kind of the birth of programs like this and looked into the Synanon cult, and next week we're going to look into the troubled teen industry of more recent history, and just like Sage said, we're going to talk a lot of shit about Dr. Phil. Playing us out this episode, our very own Leon Filger reading a love poem. See you in the after show.
Hello, occultists, and welcome back to Occulte Veritatis podcast. I don't really know what the fuck this is. It's some sort of Patreon content that you'd ask me to record. These are my two favorite love poems as recited by Leon Filger. The first is Sonnet 17 by Pablo Neruda, and it goes something like this. I do not love you as if you were the salt rose or topaz, or the arrow of carnations that propagates fire. I love you as certain dark things are loved, secretly, between the shadow and the soul. I love you as the plant that doesn't bloom, but carries hidden within itself the light of those flowers. And, thanks to your love, darkly in my body lives the dense fragrance that rises from the earth. I love you without knowing how, or when, or from where. I love you simply without problems or pride. I love you in this way because I know no other way of loving. But this, in which there is no you or I, so intimate that your hand upon my chest is my hand, so intimate that when you fall asleep, it is my eyes that close. And now Shakespeare's 116th sonnet. Let me not to the marriage of true minds admit impediments. Love is not love which alters when it alteration finds, or bends with the remover to remove. Oh no. 'Tis an ever-fixed mark that looks on tempests and is never shaken. 'Tis a star to every wandering bark, whose worth's unknown though his height be taken. Love's not time's fool, though rosy lips and cheeks within his bending sickle's compass come. Love alters not with his brief hours and weeks, but bears it out, even to the edge of doom. If this be error, and upon me proved, I never writ, nor no man ever loved.
It's been a while since we prayed to our goddess, and this is a cult after all. Before we pray to her, asking for blessings, we must pray to her and give her some worship. Here is the prayer of Valhalla. Repeat after me. Now I lay thee down to sleep. Pray for Val my soul to keep. If I die before I wake, in hell I will fetch her chocolate cake. Lovely, first and foremost from our patrons, from Papa Bray, chur this mighty Val, I'm trying to drop a couple kg to be a swole boy. Please help me focus on this workout routine I started. I fear that beer and video games will be the death of me. Praise be, many a ram will be sacrificed with single punches when I'm jacked. Valhalla, grant dear Papa Bray his wish. from Patron Dr. Bubbles Pond. O Valhalla, glory to thee. I just accepted my first developer job at a 2% stock in a trading company. Please fortify my creativity to churn out compelling content and bless this company's success. Their success is my success, and my success shall be the world's. You know, we all gotta participate in capitalism, and I respect your hustle, Dr. Bubbles Pond, as does our goddess, Valhalla. Valhalla, please give Mr. Bubbles Pond luck in his new venture. Sent to our Twitter account. Dear Valhalla, my mother-in-law is starting to say things that remind me of your QAnon episodes. Conspiracy theories that are both unprovable and outlandish. Please give me the strength to make it through Christmas in the coming months. Val, I hope that you help this person that anonymously asked to pray for you on Twitter to have enough courage to keep their mouth shut or open it, whatever they choose to do, at Christmas. I just caution that, at least for me, I think the most equitable option to protect my mental health is to not argue with people from QAnon, but that's just me. Maybe it's unavoidable. All right, that's it. That's all. If you want to contribute to the next time we pray, if you're in the Discord, just put it in the Pray to Valhalla channel. I'll read it off there. You guys get first priority. If you guys anonymously email us, feedback@ovpod.ca, we can read your prayers on there. If you send it to the inbox of any of our social media accounts, we'll also read it from there. We love feedback, and we love having our goddess rain down blessings upon us, and she really does love us. So she tries her best to make sure we're taken care of. Join us next episode for what could be thought of as Synanon Part 2, or the thing that Synanon evolved to, the troubled teen industry of the modern age, and that fuck Dr. Phil. See you then!